I'm Anna Miller, the associate pastor here at First United Methodist Church in Albany, and welcome to Sunday School. I am so excited to be able to share with you today. Brandon and Laurel have been doing a wonderful job with our Advent Sunday School book, The Wonder of Christmas. And today, I'm going to share with you The Wonder of the Manger. Now, I'm pretty excited about my setup here. I've got a manger here. I've got a manger on the Christmas tree. I told Callie I had an idea of where and how I wanted to set this up and film it, and she was a little unsure. You know, those who are really good at sets, when somebody says they have an idea, they're a little skeptical, but she came in and she approved this. So I'm Miss Uncreative here. I'm pretty excited about my little setup here. But I want you to stop first before you continue any more with the video, and I want you to read and wonder for yourself. Let the three scripture selections speak to you. Pray before you read. Let the Holy Spirit teach you what He has for you today. And then pick up the book, and we're in pages 67 to 95. I want you to read that for yourself. You see, it's hard for us to wonder what the Holy Spirit has for us when we already have someone else's ideas and thoughts in mind. So stop the video if you haven't already and read that for yourself. You know, the thing about Sunday school that's different from school, education in the real world, if you will, is that we do our homework beforehand. If we do our homework and we read and we wonder, we let the Holy Spirit teach us, then when we come together as a group in Sunday school, it makes for some great interaction. It makes for a wonderful opportunity for all of us to come together to look at the scripture from different angles and to be able to get a really true picture of what God's saying in the scriptures. So stop the video, do a little wondering for yourself, and then we're going to come back and we're going to start reading from Luke. Today we're going to be in Luke 2, and we're going to start out with 1 through 7. What does it mean that Jesus was born and placed in a manger? What are some implications? What are some thoughts that we may have never considered before? Let's read this and see what the Holy Spirit is talking to us today. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them at the inn. No room for them at the inn. Can you imagine that? What would that look like today, if we were on a trip, if we were traveling, and it got nighttime, and we were ready to stop for the night, and there was no room at the inn or the motel or hotel or Airbnb, this was definitely way before smartphones, what would we have done? You know, I remember years ago, Keith and I were driving from Colorado. And we were going to drive just as long as we could and then stop for the night. Well, we were so excited because we had driven about 13 hours that day. And we finally stopped and got close in Talladega, Alabama. Now, what is in Talladega but the Talladega Super Speedway? And it just so happened that 11:30 at night, we stopped to get a room and all the rooms were booked up because the Talladega 500 was going on. We had to get back in the car. Now, this was before smartphones, where we could just call or even look up a hotel room. We would stop, and I would go in the front desk and say, hey, do you have any rooms for the night? And they said no. Well, this continued for 3 hours. It was 3 o'clock in the morning before Keith and I finally found a hotel room. We were exhausted. I can imagine what it would have been like to not find room at the inn. Let's continue on. I want to read verses 8 through 16. What happened after that? In the region, there were shepherds living in the fields, watching over their flock by night. And then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you the good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you, and you will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to the highest in heaven, and on earth peace among whom he favors." And when the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which is the Lord, that he has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in a manger. What and why a manger? And what would that have looked like? You know, we put chrismons on our tree in the shape of a manger. We envision mangers maybe looking like this with hay, and I really hope she didn't wrap him in burlap because that's really rough. You know, we have ideas of what a manger may have looked like, this little baby Jesus. And you can see that this one is tilted a little bit. I doubt a feeding trough, a real manger, would have looked like this. It probably would have been straight. This one even has a little pillow. Maybe Jesus is all comfortable with ornate little blanket here. Callie's going to put a couple of pictures of a manger that we might envision in a child's book what a manger looked like. We have all these preconceived notions of what that feeding trough might have looked like. And here is a picture of probably what the real manger looked like at the time. You see, close to Bethlehem in the mountains of Judea, there would have been caves in the side of the mountain, and more than likely, this feeding trough, maybe for the sheep, would have looked like a stone bed. It would have been hard. It would have been cold. Now, tradition says that we're most familiar with it, a stable looked kind of like a barn. There might have been the stables in the back of the inn or close by where they found finally to bed down. But there's evidence to say that the caves found in the limestone around Judea, these caves were often used as stables, especially for those shepherds that we just read about that were very nearby. And so this might be the picture of an actual manger carved from stone where the animals would have fed. And this gives meaning to what we find in the Old Testament. If we look back to Isaiah 33:16 says, "They will live on the heights. Their refuge will be the fortress of rocks, and their food will be supplied and water assured." You see, in the fortress of the rocks, we find the living water and food for our spiritual life that came with the birth of Jesus Christ. As we think about this Old Testament and what this looks like, that is very interesting. The shepherds would have been nearby. They came close that night, were led to believe by these verses, as they were the first ones to see Jesus. And so I'm going to be pointing out some other various scriptures in this lesson for us to get a whole picture. Old Testament, New Testament, post Jesus' resurrection, for us to see what it might have meant for Jesus to have been born in a manger and placed in a manger. Now, regardless of what this manger looked like, whether it was wooden structure or cold stone, this was definitely an unsavory and unsanitary place for a newborn to rest his wee little head, much more the King of Kings. We are led to believe that Jesus came in very humble means, very humility. He was humbled to the station of a human, yet divine, for us, to live among us, his lowly people. Now, how ironic it is that the King of Kings would have done this for us, who could have provided a place. We don't know why God ordained that he came to the manger in humble means, but we're going to explore it a little bit today. One of the things that came to my mind as I wonder about the manger is how ironic it is that our shepherd, our true shepherd, was placed in the feed trough for the sheep. Now, we know that the sheep were the sacrifice paid for our sins. And so the food that fed these sheep so that the sheep could be sacrificed, now the ultimate sacrifice was being placed in the food trough. Jesus, the ultimate and final sacrifice, the Savior, so that we might have life, the bread of life, even. You see, Jesus is our spiritual food for living, and it is he who sustains us. He is our bread of life. And what great love it is that God has for us. I want to look at page 74 in your book. As we've looked at these images, as we've looked at these notes, why the manger? You know, definitely the manger and these humble means are not what we would have expected for our King. Our King of Kings and our Lord of Lords. But I can't help but think that this is surely God's divine plan. Jesus coming into the world is not what we would have imagined. Definitely, he kind of turned everything upside down from our preconceived notions. And God's ways are mysterious. And so as we wonder and we think about this, let's look at the location. We know that the location in Bethlehem, that this would have fulfilled divine prophecy in the Old Testament. We know that a king was coming and that Jesus is going to come the king and reign over all the world. But we didn't expect him to come in these humble means. But we know that kings reign, and Jesus is going to reign in a very different way than we expect. He reigned, and he also came to serve. Jesus came to serve us. There is something new here that is happening. Now, we make kings, human kings, in our life. We've got the Book of Kings, but now this is the King of Kings coming in Jesus to reign. Jesus turns our human ways upside down, and even the greatest of kings are to serve Jesus now in the New Testament time. Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, yet this King, this Savior came and paid the price for our sin so that we may have life. King Jesus came to save us. And Jesus is the only King who can save us. And so as we look at this, you know, I want to think about some of those movies, our favorite old-timey movies. If you're a girl like me, you probably like those old-timey movies where there's kings and lords and ladies and dresses. And often in those movies, we hear the term, at the king's pleasure. Whatever the king's pleasure is, will be done. But Jesus is the King of Kings. It is His pleasure that He came to save us. It is for His pleasure that He created us. It is His pleasure that He was born and died on the cross so that we might have life in Him. How awesome and great is that love that our Lord has for us. Jesus surely is the bread of life. He is our Savior, and He gives life and makes it possible for us to have reconciliation with God. I want to jump over to some verses in John. John 6, 35 through 51. This is sitting in your notes. But as we think about why the manger and why Jesus came and was placed in the manger, what is His saying, I am the bread of life? What does that mean for us? Now, this is just my wondering. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But I said this to you, that you have seen me and yet do not believe. Everything that the Father gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me, I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but the one of Him who sent me. And this is the will of Him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that He has given me, but raised it up in the last day. This is indeed the will of my Father, that all who see the Son and believe in Him may have eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. And then the Jews began to complain about Him because Jesus said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. And they were saying, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can He say, I have come from heaven? And Jesus answered, do not complain among yourselves. No one can come to me unless drawn by the Father who sent me, and I will raise that person up in the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes from me. I want to stop right there. Think about the manger and Mary and Joseph. You know, as we are explaining to children about where we came from when they're very young, this is what they're saying. Isn't this Jesus, the baby whom Joseph and Mary had? That's the physical identity. Our earthly parents are the physical identity of whom we belong to and whom we came from. But Jesus is saying something different. You know, this might be a little baby in the manger, but I really came from my Father so that they might have life. And as we continue, not that anyone has seen the Father except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Very truly, I tell you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. But this is the bread that comes from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. And whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. Isn't it ironic that Jesus came to the manger to feed the sheep, that final sacrifice, that he is? The sheep were the sacrifice all throughout the Old Testament. But there's something new here. Jesus is the final and ultimate sacrifice. He is the bread of life. And he is the one at his pleasure created us so that we might have life. I love this, that Jesus came to serve. And so I want to ask us, how do we serve the Lord? How do we obey? How are we obedient and serve the Lord as Jesus was obedient and served the Lord? Our next scripture selection is Colossians 1, 19 and 20. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in Jesus, and through him to reconcile himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through Jesus' shed blood on the cross. Jesus came that we might have life. This is salvation. This is our Christian hope, that with Jesus' coming, that he served the Lord by his sacrifice, his being the bread of life, that we might have abundant life and have eternal life. And he is our example of how we are to obey God and serve God so that others can come into his kingdom too. As we think about Jesus's obedience, I want to read our last scripture selection, Philippians 2, 6 through 11. As we look at this full circle, listen to how Jesus fulfills prophecy by his coming. Though he was God, Jesus, though Jesus was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges and he took the humble position of a servant and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself and in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on the cross. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all other names, that the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue declare that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Jesus came in humble means for you and for me. And he did all this to the glory of God. God knew that we were going to need a Savior. And at his pleasure, he sent Jesus to us. As you talk more in your Sunday school class, there's some other questions in your discussion guide I want y'all to talk about and explore. What does the wonder of the manger mean to you? I want to close in prayer for you, and I hope that y'all have a really good Sunday school discussion and lesson. Let me pray for you. Lord Jesus, I stand in awe that you would humble yourself and come to earth to live among us, to love us, serve us, and fight even on our behalf, being willing to give up your very life so that we might truly live. How grateful we are for your surprising and wonderful divine plan. Open our eyes this season to the wonder of the manger, an unlikely crib that heralds your humble and eternal reign. May this beautiful picture of your love profoundly change us, and may we follow your example by humbling ourselves to love and serve others in your name. It is in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. I hope you have a good lesson, and we'll see you next time.